Wednesday, it's 7 o'clock. It's time for Magic TV. I'm Mashi Scanlon at The Guy on the Left. Two very special guests with me this week. In-house, I've got Matt Nass at Matthew Nass. And all the way from Chicago via Skype, we're very, very lucky to have Gaby Spartz with us at Gaby Spartz. How are you doing, Gaby?
I'm good, Mashi. How are you?
I'm doing well. Matt?
Also good.
Oh, everybody's good. That's great. Beats the alternative. You know, one day I'm going to open with that and someone's going to say, you know, Mosh, it's been a real rough day. And that's just going to derail the whole show. That day's not today, thankfully.
Next time.
We got a lot of great stuff on Magic TV today. We've got news. A lot of stuff happened this week, which is going to be a lot of fun to talk about. Gaby, if you don't know yet, Gaby was gracious enough to submit an article, which we published this week on channelfireball.com. It has garnered the most comments of any article ever on CFB. I think it's got the most comments of any Magic-related article on Reddit. I mean, it has
I think it's the second most commented article on Reddit.
Yeah, it's got like 1,100 comments. It's insane. Wow. Immediately called messaged Gaby and said, hey, can we get you on Magic TV? And very graciously accepted on a day's notice. So thanks again, Gaby.
No problem.
So we get to talk with Gaby about her article. And then we have a little we have a pro tour coming up, so we have a little pro tour draft. So that should be a lot of fun too. Before we get into any of that, I just want to remind you, Magic TV is brought to you by channelfireball.com. We're hosting Grand Prix Las Vegas. We got the registration rewards. I think we're at about 4,030 right now. Foil Marsh Flat is the next prize at 4,100. Of course, 4,493, we break the record, which was set at the prior Vegas. So that's all exciting. If you haven't signed up for Vegas, do that. Other than that, you know, we just wrapped up the yard sale. We just finished the Dragons release. The deal of the week this week is M13, which is a bit auspicious because I just learned, Gaby, that's when you started playing. So in celebration of Gaby, because we can say that now.
Yeah, of course.
In celebration of having Gaby, our deal of the week is M13 boxes at $74.99. The deal of the day is Monastery Mentor in celebration of Matt Nass. This is unbelievable. These sales just came together perfectly. We got Monastery Mentor and M13. Yeah. So check out channelfireball.com. We would appreciate it. On to this week's news. And there's been a lot of crazy stuff. It's weird. Kind of sitting down thinking about, okay, what are we going to talk about? Oh, we've got this news stuff. And more news kind of trickled in. Let's start with the drier stuff. One, we have this change in platinum levels. Now, obviously, none of us are platinum pro players right now. Otherwise, we'd probably be in Brussels. Yeah. I think all of us one day aspire to be platinum players.
Oh, absolutely.
Definitely.
How do you guys feel about this? Gaby, in terms of professional play and aspirations as a grinder, how do you feel about lowering the threshold? Because I think Wizards is sending a message that, hey, they're trying to make the idea of a full-time professional player more accessible.
Oh, definitely. I think the nuances of the 2 points difference is a little far away from me, but I like the message that Wizards is sending by doing that.
Yeah, I mean, it's a policy choice. What do you think, Matt?
Yeah,
I've never been platinum before, but I've been at least somewhat close at sometimes. Right now I'm at 16 points, so still need another, 30 to get there. But I do like the idea. A lot of my friends are, from
of
Team
course,
CFB are really close.
Yeah.
And I've had friends in the past who, got 44 points when platinum was 45.
Jacob Wilson did that, right? Didn't he get...
I think Jacob's been close. Sam Pardee was close last year.
The birds.
Lucas Blohan got 44 when 45 was the cut once. So a lot, these 2 points seem small, but they could mean, they could mean thousands of dollars to a few people.
Whoever's there. And I know, just from speaking to people behind the scenes in organized play, trying to create the idea that this is something you could do and make it more lucrative and possibly something you could engage in. Is a goal of theirs, and they set that platinum threshold one to see how many they got. Maybe they got a little bit less than expected, so they can lower the threshold, bring it down a little bit. I wish they'd lowered gold, 9 short points, and Cheon's automatically gold. You don't have to worry about this. I'm agonizing over Cheon for this Pro Tour. It's killing me.
It is stressful.
But we got to wait, and I think that hopefully this presages the idea that they're taking the notion of professional play and professional players seriously. So that's always good news for all of us who aspire to that level.
Yeah, for me, gold is the target I tend to look for, and so seeing that still at the pretty high 35 is a bit discouraging.
Get that down to 30?
Yeah,
come on.
Something like that would be nice.
Alain, Matthew, anyone? Is anyone watching? How about 30 for gold? So speaking of qualifying for the Pro Tour, there was also a change on PPTQs. PPTQs now have to follow a certain format. They have to either be the format of the Pro Tour they're feeding into or sealed. Now, speaking from our own experience at the Channel Fireball Game Center, we did. This was basically done because nobody was running modern PPTQs. Everyone was running standard. Speaking from our own experience, we ran a modern PPTQ and we had 130 people for it. So wow. It was still very popular for us.
Wow.
I haven't played in a PPTQ. I haven't played in a PTQ. The last time I played in a PTQ, the last time I played in a PTQ, it was a Lorwyn Shadowmoor block. That was the format of the PTQ.
Yikes.
So it's been a while.
Did you play fairies?
No, I did not. I played this. Oh, God. My brew was awesome. It had Chameleon Colossus, Ashimor Gouger. It was like this LD. You played the red Incendiary Command to blow things up, Fulminator Mage. It was basically LD, which should surprise no one who's watched this show. It was the one LD deck in the format. It was the first PTQ I'd played ever. Okay? It was almost 200 people. And I knew one other person in the tournament, and he was my round one opponent. So what are the odds, right? I ended up, for the record, I know you're not watching this pin. I'm going to put it out there right now. I know that slip says you won, but we both know I crushed you in two games, and then I scooped. Because he's it's Alex Alapin.
Yeah,
he's a much better, he's actually my roommate right now. He's a much better player than I am. So I was like, look, I'm going to scoop. I didn't tell him that. I wanted to play it out seriously, so we played it out. Yeah. Crushed him. I cannot emphasize this. Crushed him, and then signed the slip in his favor. But as people who I'm sure have played in more PTQs and PPTQs recently, how do you feel about this, Gabby? How do you feel about this change?
I think it's a good change. There was a legacy PPTQ here that had 8 people, and they were giving decks to people so that this thing would fire. And it wasn't a PPTQ, it was a cut to top 8 PPTQ. And, you know, like, this is not the first time I've heard of that happening. So it seems to make sense. It seems to keep people more focused. I live in Chicago, so the Magic scene is actually pretty diverse, and there were PPTQs of every format. But I've generally seen people be very embracing of the idea of being able to focus on one format and just working on that and trying to go to a number of PPTQs for that specific format instead of being like, this is the standard one, and then the sealed one, and then the legacy one that almost didn't fire.
I mean, if you had if you could choose a format for a PPTQ, what would it be?
I'd probably pick standard. I have the most experience playing standard, and I probably had the most success playing standard too, even though draft is my favorite format.
I think everyone loves draft, but it's sealed, so you can't do the draft. The only person I know who loves sealed more than draft is Paul Rietzel. Not Chion Rietzel. Yeah. He loves sealed. He plays like infinite sealed on Moto.
Yeah.
All right, Matt, how about you? Good change, bad change?
Yeah, good change.
Yeah.
I think, as Gabby said, if you're someone who really wants to practice and you decide, I want to try my absolute hardest to qualify for this Pro Tour, I'm going to go to lots of PPTQs and stuff. Mm-hmm. Being able to try to work really hard on one format, get familiar with one deck, is so much easier than having to bounce around. And so I think rewarding that is good. Also, it's the same format as the Pro Tour, so that's a nice bonus too.
Or sealed.
Yeah, or sealed.
I was going to add that seems like a really nice thing about having it be that format. It just gets you to care so much more about the Pro Tour.
Yeah, and I mean, and that's how they used to do the old PTQs, right?
Yeah.
But so here's the question.
If you do qualify, you're not like blindsided. Like,
right, you're somewhat prepared.
You play block constructed. You qualify block constructed for a modern PTQ PT or something, and you don't even have modern cards. You can't find Tarmogoyf.
Right.
Or something. It's a lot trickier.
How many? Let me ask this. For the modern Pro Tour, Matt, do you think there's going to be more sealed PPTQs or modern PPTQs?
Compared to when it's standard, I would guess that people will push seal. Like, modern is less popular than standard, I think. So
it is, but modern's still wildly popular.
Yeah, still wildly popular, but a little less. So I would expect a little more sealed during that season.
What do you think, Gabby?
Modern, I think.
I agree. I think we're going to see a lot more.
It'll still be over half modern, probably.
Hey, stores are really, really happy when you come in and buy all their modern cards.
That is a good point.
So hopefully we'll push that. I love modern, so hopefully we'll see a little bit more modern. So that's the PPTQ change. We also have, so the GP Las Vegas thing, it's part of this Modern Masters weekend. And I don't know if you guys saw this.
Chiba.
Did you follow, Gabby, did you follow the registration for Grand Prix Chiba?
No, I didn't.
4,000 players, sells out in 10 hours and 20 minutes. They averaged one registration every 10 seconds. It was six players.
I actually heard about this.
Unbelievable. I know Saito has had questionable play, but I know Saito just from being at GPs and talking to him. He's a super nice guy, and he's a family man now. He's got his wife and his kid. I could not be happier for him. This was just an unbelievable thing to see. You know, it went live, and within an hour, it sold 2,000. It was just
insane.
It was crazy. People were posting on Facebook, and it would be like, hey, if you want to sign up for Chiba, sign up now. Only 600 spots left. And then 2 minutes later, there's a comment, 575. And then 2 minutes after that, there's another comment. And it's just like, what is happening?
Yeah, it's really strange because they've ran a lot of Japanese GPs in the past, but I guess it's just the Modern Masters that is such a big incentive for people.
Yeah, I think the last Chiba GP was very popular too. It's also a 4,000-person cap, 4,000-person sellout, so that's a little scary. It's funny, came into the office and was talking to Channel Fireball President and CEO John Sasso about this, and I posed the question, if we had a sellout of 5,000 on Vegas, how quickly do you think that would have sold out? Any thoughts on how... Let's say we announce... Okay, look, 5,000 is the maximum for GP Las Vegas.
As it is not capped, right, at 5,000?
10,000.
10,000.
10,000. Yeah, 10, yeah. We gave ourselves some breathing room here.
Yeah.
So I think we could beat the 10-hour, 20-minute mark. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah, I think it's very possible.
That would
possible.
Be wild, yeah. I think it's possible, too.
Yeah, oh, yeah, yeah. So that would have been insane. But congratulations to Grand Prix Chiba. I hope if you were planning on making it to Chiba or getting out there, you pre-reg because it's done.
I wonder if they could consider raising the cap and getting a bigger space if it's that popular or something.
You know, it's tough.
It might be a product issue also. I don't know exactly.
I think it's more...
What was the cap there? Was it a venue size problem?
It was a venue size problem. Okay. I mean, Japan's smaller.
Yeah.
I mean, I think we've all been to Japan, right?
I have been.
You have been? Okay.
Yeah.
It's... Scale's different.
It's dense.
And when you haven't been to Europe's the same way, right?
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
It's tough to find these big places. I think that 5,000 is probably the sellout no matter what.
Because it's going to be tough for them to get a place.
They're forcing us to start a second GP at 5,000. So my thinking is, okay, at 5,000, that's probably it. But 1,000 more, and I think he's going to sell those. He sold 4,000 in 10 hours, 20 minutes.
Unbelievable.
So super exciting. Slightly less exciting.
Yeah, that's awesome. I wish I could have gone to that. It is pretty far away.
What are you talking about, Gabby? You're coming to Vegas.
I know. That's so close, though.
That's the one you want to go to.
Vegas is pretty cool.
I would love to go to Chiba. And I hear there's like a Ron Foster, who works in Wizards Organized Play and handles a lot of their Japanese. I was talking to him about it. And he said there's a really, really good sushi place right around the corner from the venue. Because he's super excited about going. He's like, there's this sushi place around the corner.
Man.
So find Ron. I don't know if he's on Twitter, but find Ron Foster if you're going to Chiba. Hit him up. He knows all the spots. I mean, he speaks fluent Japanese. He's really dialed into everything going on there. So if you have questions about that, you can hit him up. But he definitely said there's a great sushi.
The last Pro Tour Chiba it was Worlds in Chiba. It was the last Pro Tour I missed until very recently.
And
I was pretty frustrated.
Yeah.
I missed by one pro point.
Oh.
So there you go. Sometimes
there you go.
You can miss by one.
Those points matter.
Yeah.
Those points matter.
Yeah.
So that's our news. Is there anything that came out that I missed? Those are the big things that popped up on my radar.
I got nothing.
I think that's it. All
right,
well, you know, Gabby, you wrote this article. it was a good, quick read. I literally kind of read it over breakfast. I think I mentioned this earlier. I read it over breakfast, and when I first looked at it, there were 9 comments, and I knew right then, okay, there's going to be a lot more comments on this before it's over. Matt, you had a chance to take a look at the article?
I did. I didn't read the comment section too carefully.
I have to confess, I have not. I think the last time I caught up on comments on Channel Fireball, we were about 400. I think it's 800 plus at this point.
Yeah, I think it's broken 800 at this point.
Yeah, and then Reddit, I saw right when it was posted, and there was 50 comments, and then 100 comments, and about somewhere between 200 and 300. I didn't keep up, and now there's 1,100, so I am woefully ignorant of all the Reddit comments and of at least 50% of the Channel Fireball comments. But I think, articles of this type have been written before, and they're always important, and it's tough because part of our communities were gamers. A lot of times and I'm going to speak from my own experience here, so I don't want this to be one of these things where, hey, he's talking about other people or other gamers or even Matt and Gabby, because I'm not. I'm talking about my own experience here. Sometimes we fall into certain niches and cultural groups by default. And being a gamer can definitely be part of that. And this article addressed that cultural enclave, you know. So like when I was still cool and young and hip and about 30 pounds heavier than I am now and longer hair, sitting in the back of chemistry, grinding with my old magic deck, running Armageddon Equinox, thinking that the Equinox would somehow counter the Geddon from my lands but not my opponent's lands, so I didn't know very much about how to play Magic. I wasn't exactly what you'd call the coolest guy in school. So, that was my niche. I played Magic, and I had a lot of friends who played Magic, and that's what we did. And I think this article is great. I think it's awesome. And I think there was some negative reaction to it, and I think part of that negative reaction is premised on the idea of, hey, this is my safe place. This is my community. And even though this article takes a very constructive tone about how to make this community and this cultural group more accepting of women, and it's 6 points for how to, you know, draw women into Magic, I think a lot of people immediately, when they feel that critique, shields up. There's a problem here. Let me find something wrong with it. So there's been a lot of criticism, Gabby. How do you feel about it?
Yeah, you know, I got a confession to make, too. I didn't get a lot of work done yesterday at work. mostly because I was trying to keep up with everything that people were saying, because on top of, you know, the 800-something comments on Channel Fireball and the 1,000-something comments on Reddit, I also got a lot of tweets, a lot of messages, you know, all sorts of online communication from people who read this article. And I was actually talking to Luis about this. I was simultaneously filled with hope in seeing so many people who want the change to happen. They see the importance of it. They understand why it's good. They want to help, and they don't know how. And then at the same time, if you go into the comments section, you see some really, really negative stuff. You know, people's, you know, it is people's safe place. And I think people have very strong feelings when it comes to this. And so a lot of attacks on different points, mostly nuances, it's actually surprising that it's not, you know, people making the argument that the Magic doesn't need more women, which is surprising to me because that's not what I'm arguing at all. Obviously, Magic doesn't need more women to be a great game. The game is fantastic. It reaches a great demographic, and it's growing faster than ever. The point is that there's things that we can do to make it a more inclusive community to women, and it's not, you know, it's not an ultimatum. It's not like, oh, the game needs women or it's going to die. And so people were taking that approach, which I thought was interesting because it's not the point that I was trying to make at all. But yeah, it seems like just a lot of people stepped up to the plate. There was a lot of controversy. There was a lot of people who had very strong feelings about it. But overall, I think I like opening up the discussion. It seems to have created a lot of healthy discussion about gender issues.
Matt, what's your take on the article, 6 ways to have women?
Yeah, I really liked it. I think one thing that was interesting about this article, as opposed to some other ones, is that the target audience was a little bit different, I felt like. Like, a lot of time when you see articles like this, they're about the people who are, like, kind of really, like, misogynists or, like, really, like, hate women almost. Yeah. And this article was saying, no, even if you're just a random person in a Magic tournament, you know, just an innocent bystander, or you could still be somewhat contributing to the problem or be able to help more.
I think, yeah, I mean, and you talk about this, Gabby, your first point with the, you know, don't bring up the fact that I'm a girl. And some people were commenting on this about how because you encounter a female player at a tournament, you may say something like, oh, hey, this is awesome. I can't believe the girl's playing here, or, you know. And instantly that frames the conversation, that frames the match as you're a woman playing Magic. And that does bring an element. Like I for instance, I've never sat down with someone and say, oh my gosh, you know, you're Asian. I can't. You know, you wouldn't see something like that. And I know it's not a 1-to-1. I get that. Don't come after me for that. But it's well meaning. It's not meant to be like, oh, you're a girl playing Magic. It's like, oh, you know, some people could just say like, hey, this is great. I've never had a. We don't only get girls at this FNM. It's great that we have you here. And how that in itself has an incremental effect, and how that frames the whole situation and gives a certain context to the whole match. I completely agree, Gabby, with what you were saying about the nuances and the things that people were coming after you for. One of the things I was a teaching assistant years ago, and one of the things I found in those days was people like to find ways to tear things down because it validates a sense of intelligence. Like, you know, hey, I read this, but you know what? I'm smart enough to see what's wrong with it and the mistakes with it and where it's gone wrong, and that means I'm smart. And I always used to tell the students, like, hey, you know, this wasn't Gaby Spartz, this was like Socrates we were reading, so it's a little bit more difficult when it's like, why, you know, maybe you take a second and say, and I invite everyone who has any disagreements with this article and anyone who's read this article or has qualms or questions about it, I really invite you, this is some advice I've given both my brothers and anyone that I've come across working with, take a second and just buy in. Just buy in. Try to see what's right about everything being said. Because that's going to be so much more constructive. And by the way, if you do that, if you take that exercise seriously, you are so much more compelling and powerful when you come to the table with what you think is mistaken. Because you've given it a chance. And you've said to yourself, okay, this is the mindset. This is how I accept it. This is what I think is right. And blah, 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 blah. And then you go, you know, it's like a pair of shoes. Didn't fit right. So here's why I didn't like that. What did you think in terms of... go ahead.
Go ahead.
I was just saying...
No, you go ahead.
There's been a lot of... there's trolls. There's been a lot of random comments. One of the things that I knew was happening, and it was like, are we going to keep this, is great article for a girl. Nice job for a girl. Which is one of the things that's addressed, you know, so it's haha, it's a joke, but it's kind of what we're talking about, but haha, it's a joke, but it's a joke that reinforces the complete point of the article. But what did you encounter, Gabby, because I know you've interacted with a lot more, criticisms or critiques that you sat back and said, huh, okay, maybe I didn't see that angle, maybe I didn't take that fully into consideration when I was writing this, good point.
Yeah, absolutely. So one of the things and the most important thing that I wanted to do when writing this article is I wanted to be very positive. The reason that I wanted it to be positive is because I've seen a lot of articles like this before. And I think the issue that I've seen with those kinds of articles is that sometimes they tend to be really negative. It's really easy to go up to the plate and say something like, let me put a laundry list of all the horrible things that have happened to me at a Magic tournament. And if I were to do that, it would be very long. And I don't think that's productive, because that only says no one's arguing that that's not happening. Like, no one's out there saying everything's perfect and these things don't happen to women when they go to Magic tournaments. They happen. Everybody acknowledges that these things happen. So what I wanted to do with the article is I wanted it to have a much more productive tone, right? Not just what is wrong, but what are some things that we can try to do to fix, or what are things that maybe well-meaning guys are doing that they're not aware they're not doing. So yeah, that kind of hits the point that you were saying earlier. I had a call to action at the end of the article, and it was, what did you think of the article? What did I miss? And what other suggestions do you have? And people have a lot of suggestions about things that should have been added in the article, as well as rebuttals to some of the things that I said. So some of the things that I thought were important to clarify is that while the article approaches these are things that we can do to get more women into magic, it's more like, let's give the women who are getting into magic a better chance at staying and becoming competitive. I think that was a better way to frame it, and I think that's what a lot of people were nitpicking at, and I think that's a fair point. Mm-hmm. Because we're not saying, like, people were saying, you know, a lot of times women aren't that much into you know, science fiction and things like the flavor of magic, and they're not going to be attracted to that no matter what we do in terms of environment. So the point is more, you know, you have a girl, she goes to her first FNM, and let's say that she's been playing, you know, kitchen table magic with some of her friends, and she's scared, and she's going to her first FNM, and she's really looking forward, and she thinks she's going to have a good time, and let's say she has a bad experience. You know, what are the odds that she's really going to come back? They're not very good.
Oh, I agree, and I mean, what's your take on this, Matt? I don't want to...
Oh, yeah, I completely agree, yeah.
I mean...
Yeah.
That's such a universal thing. Let me let me put my Channel Fireball Game Center hat on for a second. That's a universal thing. One of the things that we talk to our judges about at the game centers how judging, and this is true, I mean, I have a speech about this at GPs. When you go to, if you're a judge and you're a Channel Fireball GP, you've already heard this, so excuse me. But judging at Magic, a Magic tournament, be it FNM or a GP, is a customer service role. And part of what you have to do is protect the people who are first-timers. And FNM, it's more important than a GP.
Sure.
Because the game is growing at a phenomenal rate. And we want new players. New players are great for all of us. I'm sorry that they brought some crazy, wacky, five-card combo token deck to the standard FNM, and you're sick of having to play against it. But you know what? A, that guy's having fun with his deck. And B, the more... you know, he and she show up and bring these decks and participate, the better Magic gets, the more it grows. And one of the things that I saw, Gabby, which you know, similar to your experience, which this female experience you're talking about at FNM, was a lot of these points, they're just, how do we get more people into Magic?
100%.
You know, how do we get more people?
100%.
And you're kind of, people are kind of beating you up over that. You know, here's a newsflash, guys. She's a woman. She was writing it from a female perspective. The article was about attracting women to Magic. And so it's so unfair. People are like, well, this applies to everyone. Women can have bad hygiene too. Like all these things that are just like, guys, are we missing the point here? So, but I think at its base, it's about, look, number two was this, you know, have good hygiene, basically. You know, shower, brush your teeth, that kind of thing. And just... that I think that one was one you got beat up for a lot.
Oh, yeah.
And it's interesting because recently at the Game Center, we have actually posted community rules. And it includes more than hygiene, but hygiene was the motivating force behind it. We were having some issues, and it's a difficult topic to broach. But we put the rules up in order to give the staff the support to say, hey, there have been some complaints. Let's talk about this. And this was something that we worked with as a team, as a family here at Channel Fireball and the Game Center. How do we constructively approach this? This is a sensitive topic. We don't want to shame anyone. We just want to have a constructive conversation. And that's just one example of the things that you list in this article. But it's the first one that came to my mind because we have this rule. We had two players that we had to ask to leave as a result of this rule. They came back 2 days later. No problem when they came back, no problem since. And I came away from that experience. I didn't handle it. We have a great staff at the Game Center. If you haven't been there, check it out. They handled it perfectly. But I came away from hearing about that thinking to myself, this was good advice. We, as a group, as a team, as a family, as a business here at Channel Fireball, we had the courage to approach these guys and say, hey guys, you're part of our community. Can I please give you some advice? Can I talk to you about something? And it's like a life lesson. I think that it can't have just affected them at the Game Center. It will affect all facets of their life. And 100%. So much of what you've listed here, if this is adopted, it doesn't apply to just Magic. It applies to like, hey, do better, be better. And that's one of the things that really chagrined me, actually, was the idea that this is an article that says, as a community, do better. And there should never be a point in time when, as Magic players, as Channel Fireballers, as Californians, as Illini, I don't know, Illinoisans, as U.S. citizens, as world citizens, that we should ever approach a situation that's just a, hey guys, hey gals, hey everybody, do better, without some type of open arms.
Yeah, and that I think is a fair point that people had. It's that, you know, the article, I'm writing it from my perspective. I am a girl, and I do see a problem with a number of women who play Magic, especially because I have tried to get some of my girlfriends to play Magic, and you know what? It didn't go very well. I have girlfriends who don't play Magic, and, you know, I don't hang out with them as often as I would like to because, you know, they don't come to FNM with me, and because I spent a really substantive amount of my leisure time dedicated to Magic things. It's a fair point. The article could be renamed to how do we get more people into Magic? How do we make this a more inclusive community? Mm-hmm. It's not just specific to women. These are things that we should be doing as a community to improve things. Like, I am a certified yoga instructor, and I go to the yoga studio a lot, and I practice hot yoga. And when I come back from hot yoga, I am very stinky. You know, I'm going to shower before I go to FNM. It's not a males do this and females don't. Everybody can smell bad, and it's, you know, something you can do. You can shower, go to F&M, make sure that, you know, you come out and make sure that you have a good time, and you're respectful of other people who are there to have a good time as well.
Now, one of the things that I noticed for the first time, really, I was at Grand Prix Quebec, but I've been to now a few Grand Prix in Canada and in Europe. Been to one, Liverpool, going to Copenhagen. So, but Matt, maybe you can talk about this a bit. My experience is going abroad, I see more female players. I mean, have you experienced that, or is that?
Yeah, still not as many as
look. Oh yeah, it's not a 50-50 split. Yeah, like let's get real here for a second.
But yeah, I do think that's right. That at least it's a higher percentage. Yeah.
And I always wonder, because it's also, I mean, I think there's just a magic in a lot of foreign countries has a slightly different social standing than it does here in the U.S. And I think that plays into more women playing it. I too, by the way, Gaby, I am currently struggling with teaching my girlfriend magic. And so it's tough. She hasn't been to any. She's been to the game center plenty of times, but just like learning magic, just FYI, putting the time and commitment into learning the game. And for those of you,
yeah,
who,
absolutely.
You know, we all take it for granted. Yeah. The million decisions. Okay, I'm holding an instant in my hand. What's the phase? Okay, should I cast that during upkeep? A draw step after you draw. Draw step before you draw. What am I going to do with this card? All of these split second decisions. All these things that people who haven't learned to play have to learn. They have to do all that, and put yourself in their place. Man, woman, transgender, whatever it is. They're trying to keep all that in their head, and for the first time, instead of playing with my buddies Gabby and Matt, I'm going to go play with a stranger in a store. And how nervous am I? Am I going to play this wrong? Right?
I can actually talk about this, because I learned how to play not that long ago. I remember what that was like. I remember that experience very vividly. I had been... my best friend got me a deck builder's toolkit, because he wanted to play Magic, and so he got it for my birthday as a selfish gift. And he was like, you're going to play Magic with me.
Nice.
And I was like, whatever, sure, if you want to get me a selfish gift, by all means, just do it. So he got a toolkit, and then we built some decks, and then a couple people from my office who had played Magic when they were younger, they saw that we were playing with Magic cards, and they were like, I used to love this game. So like, five of us at work started playing Magic, and it was maybe 6 months after we had started playing with the really crappy deck builder toolkit decks that we all went to our first FNM. And that's so scary, because you're used to playing with these other people who know the stupid things you do. Like, at this point, I don't understand how instants work very well. So it's like, am I playing a game of chicken? Am I waiting to see if you do something and then I'll do something?
Right.
And it's scary. It's really scary, and I think if I would have had a bad experience on my first time going up, and I'm like, I don't know that I would have been very inclined to go back. I enjoy playing it with my friends at the kitchen counter, but that's very different to go play with other people who, you know, won't be as understanding, and you don't know that you're going to feel welcome there. Mm-hmm. I felt very out of place when I went to my first FNM, but everybody was very inclusive, and I had a great experience, and I continue playing at that store today.
It can be intimidating. Do you remember your first FNM, Matt?
It was a while ago, but yeah, I do. I was like pretty young at the time, and I went with my best friend actually, and so like my dad was there, and he saw all these like 25 to 35-year-old people, and he's like was like creeped out by it a fair amount, and was like really nervous. So like he would drive us to F&M every week. And
what store was it?
It was Match Play Neutral Ground.
Oh, Neutral Ground.
Anymore,
awesome. Yeah, it's not there anymore.
Yeah, 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 and. But luckily it was like so he was like creeped out at first and like would stay and watch and like do work on his computer or whatever. Mm-hmm. But luckily it was like a really awesome community and really inclusive, and so I unfortunately can't still go to the store today because it doesn't exist anymore.
Well, this habit of Mr. Nass staying for your tournaments something that definitely lasted. We called him Papa Smurf. I don't even know where that came from. I think like immediately by the time I met you. Okay, so he's Papa Smurf. There's a little story about Matt Nass, because you were playing Neutral Ground, but I still kind of feel like you grew up a bit at Channel Fireball.
I definitely did.
We had a 5K, and I know, I see you in the chat, Channel Fireball president and CEO John Sasso, and I know you know this story, because we talk about this all the time. There used to be a Starbucks Gaby, there used to be a Starbucks right next to the Channel Fire, the old Channel Fireball Game
Center. The Third Street one?
Yeah, the Third Street one downtown.
Nice.
And we just launched Channel Fireball. It's less than a year old. We're holding 5Ks. Like, oh my gosh, how are we going to do this? And are enough people going to come to cover the prize person? Oh my gosh. And here's Matt Nass. And we all kind of know Matt Nass. And he's been playing a lot. And Papa Smurf would always camp out at the Starbucks and do work. He'd have a bunch. He'd have newspapers too.
At this point, I think he was comfortable like leaving me on my own.
Right. I think you were much older now. Okay. But he would hang out there, and so because I drink way too much coffee. So I was a regular there. I would just walk in and they'd just hand me coffee and I'd walk out because I went there so much. And so I'd see him there. And I remember I was in there and we were in the finals, and someone comes in and says, "Matt just won," and Papa Smurf just stands up and he just goes running back to the game center. He's like, "Oh my god! Oh my god!" And he's like jumping up and down. This like vivid memory of your father jumping up and down when you won that 5K. It was it was awesome. It's something I'll never forget. I was also present when Matt won his first GP.
Oakland. Yeah. Interestingly, the 5K was standard, but was also with elves.
Yes. No surprise there. Matt Nass winning tournaments with elves. No
Even
surprise.
Before Oakland, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's one of my favorite memories of the
year. Yeah.
He was so fired up. He was so happy for you. We were all happy for you. So that's a great memory. But yeah, I actually remember my first FNM. And
nice.
How
long ago was that, Mashi?
It was not as long as you think. It was Masks Urza's Type 2. Standard.
That's not as long as we would think.
Well, I don't know how long they've had the FNM program for, but I was in college. I'm dating myself. I was in college, and I found this store. I'm like, I haven't played Magic in a while. I'll play some Magic. But I'd fallen out of touch. And when I'd stopped playing, the stack was like a brand new thing. Okay, this is the era where you could stack damage. Okay?
Oh, wow.
And that had just rolled out. I don't want to say it was a Mirage. Sixth edition rules, right? Sixth edition.
Yeah,
sixth. And so I kind of knew that, but I wasn't uber familiar with it. And then I come back and I'm trying to play Magic, and there's, you know, Morphlings in the format. By the way, the stack is very important, or it was very important, you know, stacking damage.
Like make it a 5/1 damage on the stack.
Yeah, and then, you know, all that kind of stuff. I mean, it was huge with Mastacore. I mean, the stack was very, very, very important. Stacking damage was huge. And I remember I'd been playing Magic for years, and I was just terrified of screwing up, you know, because like Magic was kind of something I had and something I played, something I was familiar with. Luckily, I met two great guys, Matt Densmore, Tim Valdez, shout out, who were basically the two best players in the store. And Matt and I were going to college together, and so they kind of took me under their wing, and I didn't have much to worry about in terms of embarrassing myself too much, because I kind of had, you know, that legitimacy of being with them. So, but it can be a very, very, you're so nervous. You don't want to play wrong. You don't want someone to laugh at you. Can you imagine you're playing Magic and someone laughs at you because you made a mistake? I mean,
I thought I was going to get laughed at when I went to my first FNM.
Yeah.
I remember having this like little panic attack where I was getting a pep talk from my friend.
Yeah. It's so funny. And you know, it's cause you care about the game. You want to play well. You love the game. You're doing this. You think about this. You're taking your Friday night and you're saying, "Hey, baby, you know what? I got plans tonight. I'm gonna go play some Magic. No, not Magic tricks. It's a card game. Nah, I'll tell you about it later. Okay, I gotta go." So, you know, when it's serious enough that you do that, you're taking a huge step. Getting from the kitchen table to FNM is a huge step. It takes courage, and things like this, you know, being compartmentalized because of your sex or having an off-putting experience because, you know, someone is upset because they lost you and you're a girl and they're not used to playing with girls, or, you know, the environmental concerns about comfort and all that stuff. Those little things are what, you know, first of all, cause those insecurities to go into overdrive and drive you away from the game. They're bad for everybody.
Absolutely.
So I know that I overheard you and our content manager, editor-in-chief Andy Cooper-Faust, talking about a potential follow-up to this article. What are your thoughts?
Yes. I definitely want to write something about it. I think not only did people make a lot of fair points, like, you know, the thing I mentioned earlier about how the article really is, how do we make this a more inclusive community? And I think that's a really fair point from everybody who brought it up. I think there were also some other things that people really felt strongly about. I was surprised about I wasn't surprised to see this one. I didn't want to include it in the article originally. It was playmats and sleeves that have sexy women on them.
Yeah.
That was huge. I got so many messages from people saying that. There were just a number of other things that people were talking about that I think were fair, and I think they should be addressed. I definitely want to do some sort of follow-up to this. I mean, the reaction really was just incredible.
Yeah. Well, are we going
to
get...
I'm talking to Andrew about it.
Are we going to get other Magic content out of you? You see, I'm putting it on the spot, trying absolutely. To tease out those articles. How about some draft or standard other Magic articles out of you?
Yeah, no, I certainly would love to. I think I definitely want to follow up with something like this, especially while this is very much
sure,
a hot topic.
Sure, of course.
Yeah. But yeah, I'm very interested in doing something else. I'm talking to him about it. So yeah, you can probably expect something in the near future.
If you like streaming, you could also try recording videos. It's pretty fun.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I love streaming.
Yeah, for those who don't know, Gaby also streams Wednesday nights, Thursday nights, and Saturdays if you're not traveling, is that right?
Yeah, usually if I'm not gone for like a GP or something, I'm usually streaming on Saturdays or Sundays.
So that's twitch.tv/GabbySpartz. And I haven't seen the stream, but everyone I talk to, which mainly like Luis and Chion and Raptor, who apparently have seen your stream and do watch your stream, they think it's very, very entertaining. So check it out if you're streaming that night. Do you tweet it out when you're streaming?
Yeah, I always tweet it out. Okay. I put it on social media and everywhere.
So we all have to follow at Gaby Spartz and then look to see if she's streaming.
Thank you. I love it. I'm actually watching the chat and there's a... I call everybody on the stream Vipers because Ambush Viper is my favorite card.
Nice.
Not a good reason. It just kind of happened.
Uh-huh.
I see a lot of Vipers in the chat are very excited.
That's great. I mean, streaming is such an art too. It's not like making regular videos. And I've got to say, see, I can praise Chion because he's not here.
Yeah.
And I know he's asleep in Brussels. And I know he doesn't watch the replays. And I know he doesn't download the audio because I always tell him, hey, you know, it's a good idea to download this stuff because you can hear your speech mannerisms. But his stream is one of the most entertaining things I've seen. And he does it right. You know, even though he's awful at Magic, he's not. But his streams are super entertaining. So check out Gabby's stream, obviously. Wait, did I get this right? Wednesday, Thursday, Saturday, 8 o'clock Central Time?
Yeah.
Ish. Ish.
Ish. I always tweet it out, and it's always around that time.
So that's entertaining. And I hear tell it's always limited, not much constructed going on, huh?
I've done Modern before, and whenever there is, you know, now that GP Toronto is coming up, I will probably be doing a lot more Standard, but... I had Cleveland coming up. I was doing a lot of draft for that, and I just typically tend to like draft better.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I was drafting a lot more on stream.
Doesn't everybody like draft better? I mean, Matt, what's your favorite way to play Magic?
I'm better at Constructed, definitely.
But what's your favorite way to play?
I enjoy draft. Really? I like team drafts.
Team drafts are great.
Oh, team drafts are so much fun.
Yeah.
Do you wait now? Is Emerson on your team for team drafts?
Emerson doesn't really play that much limited.
I know you're like the Magic player, so
yeah. So I got Emerson into Magic, which is usually the opposite way of how it works
right out.
Emerson,
for the record, is Gabby's husband.
Yes, okay. I should have mentioned that. And I got him into the game. I think a year after I started playing competitively, and then he got into the game as well. But I play. He doesn't really play any draft. I play a lot more draft than he does. He plays at pre-releases and stuff like that, but that's it.
Sure. I mean, I haven't been deep into draft in so long, but for some reason, Dragons, I was just talking about it a lot, and I'm like, I really need to draft Dragons. For some reason, I'm getting that itch back, where it's like,
nice.
It's been so long, I have not downloaded the newest Moto client. Magic Online client.
Yeah.
I haven't downloaded the upgrade. I'm still on version 3 on my laptop.
Wow.
I'm jealous.
I can't play anything on it. It's just that's what it is. So we can check out the stream. Okay.
I haven't been streaming at all, but I do sometimes appear on Chion's stream Skyping in from time to time.
Do you troll?
When I Skype in? No, I'm
usually pretty
legitimate.
Everybody needs to troll Chion.
You have to troll Chion.
Yeah, I should troll him more.
It's good for him. It toughens him up.
Yeah.
Last
time I was teaching him how to play Hearthstone. He did a little bit of Hearthstone on his stream.
Oh my gosh. Oh, no more of that.
Going
no
down
more
the rabbit
that.
Hole.
Magic.
That's my bad. Yeah.
Magic.
Gotta keep him on Magic.
Any final thoughts on Women of Magic, Matt Nass?
So one thing that I thought was interesting from the article was the point that there's this kind of this idea that men are better than women at Magic.
Mm-hmm.
And I just, I don't think that's true, like, in the abstract. Like, I think the reason you see more men at the top of Magic is just because so many more men play.
Right.
And, You know, there's obviously some, like, differences between men and women physically and stuff like that, but I really don't think it applies to magic, and I thought that was a really good point from your article.
That, I mean, I think that there's definitely that. It is a bizarre preconceived notion.
Yeah.
I mean, it is so, so bizarre when... And I think, you know, the example you give is, like, I got beat by a girl. How did that, what does that have to do with playing magic at, just at all, just straight up at all, what does that have to do with playing magic, you know? Is that been a, how common would you say that is, Gabby?
It's pretty common.
Wow.
Yeah, you know, it doesn't happen here in Chicago ever, mm-hmm. because I feel now people in Chicago, everybody here in Chicago that plays magic often has seen me at the stores a lot. So it's not an issue here, which is funny because you would think that that kind of thing would happen more at the FNM level. Because people at the more competitive level would conduct themselves in a different way. That aside, I feel like this has happened to me more at like the PTQ GP levels. I'm not sure. I don't know if correlation is causation here. I'm not really sure why that's the case. I've seen a lot of it happen. It can be, and sometimes it's not like the straight. Like the example that I used that happened to me at Gen Con was a guy. Specifically just telling me straight up, I can't believe I lost to a girl, I'm not going to live it down. But I've had experiences that were backhanded compliments sometimes. Maybe they were well-meaning, but they were still, like, very easy to misinterpret and just still harmful and hurtful in some way.
Well, it seems like, even if it's not meant to be harmful, kind of expressing that thought... It shows what you, it shows what the thought process is here. The thought yeah. process is, you're a woman, I lost to you. That is somehow a factor in my thinking of how I view this
of
loss.
How you should play.
Right.
It's embarrassing or something.
Right.
Yeah, I have a good example for you. I actually chose not to include this one in the article because I thought it would steer the conversation a little negatively. But it was originally in the first draft. I was playing in game day locally, and mm-hmm. it was like a 5-round game day or something, and so I ended up winning it. And
Nice.
As I go up to get my packs and my playmat and whatever else, I have this guy come up to me, and he comes up to me and shakes my hand, and I was like, this is a strange way for you to introduce yourself. And he says, I just wanted to thank you. And so I'm like, oh, why? I didn't play this guy. And he says, oh, my friend who's standing over there, and there's the guy, you know, at the back of the store, he says, he made a bet with me. He bet me that women could not be good at magic. And I told him that he was being dumb and that wasn't true. So I took on this bet with him, and it's been ongoing until today because today you proved him wrong. So thank you. Shakes my hand and he goes.
Oof.
And so, yikes, right? Because yeah. at the same time, it's like, well, I'm very happy that you bet your friend that this isn't the case, but your friend's still back there, and you still told me that he thought that women are inherently stupid and can't play magic. That's right. Basically what he said.
Yeah.
Because his argument, too, was that women could not be good at magic, that women are not good magic players.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It's just bizarre. I don't know. I mean, there aren't many women who play magic compared to the men.
Yeah.
So, yes, men dominate the top of the standings. So... It's interesting. The final question I had, unless did you have another thought on women in magic, Gabby?
No, I
got it all out there.
It's been said already.
Yeah, it's interesting on that point. I don't know about magic in particular, but for chess, there's been some research on this, and the data suggests that if you look at like kind of the bell curve of skill mm-hmm. for chess,
sure.
The men and women bell curve looks very almost identical, except the male one. Stretches out further because there's more people who play.
Right.
So you'll see more men who are at the bottom and more men who are at the top.
Because there's just
that's
more.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And
that
so,
makes sense.
So yeah, there's really no evidence, at least for chess, and I would assume it would be similar for magic.
The other thing, the final thing I will say that I found striking is the idea of the role model, and just how important, what factor do you think that plays that. How big a factor, how important do you think the idea of a female magic role model is, Gabby?
I think it's huge. I can tell you from experience, after Melissa's top 8, I saw a lot more women players here in Chicago and who are not playing anymore. You know, I think this really resonated with people because they said the way I framed it helps you understand it from the other perspective. Like, how would you feel if you were invested in this game and everyone who is casting is male or is female, and everybody who's writing content is female,
sure,
and everybody who's commenting is female? Like, how do you feel when you show up at the store and you're like, oh, is there something wrong with me? Like, should I not like this? Is it weird that I'm liking this as much as I do? And I think that really put it in perspective for some people. So I think it's huge. I think it's tremendously important to have role models like that. And the other thing that people misconstrued is that you should just randomly, you know, blindly throw support at someone just because of their gender, which is not the point. It's that, you know, maybe there's not a woman, a professional player that's a woman that's in the top right now, but there's plenty of players who play competitively and they're trying to do things. There's plenty of streamers out there, you know, who are trying to get better and they're trying to produce content. And I see them get hate and stuff on their chat all the time, and it's unnecessary and it's uncalled for. You know, support those women who are actively trying to do something to make things better. Don't bash on them.
I agree. Man, I don't know who would really disagree with that. I would just add that, you know, role models come in so many different forms, and the role models that we need to preserve in so many ways. They're not just, you know, Melissa, obviously top eight. You know, she's at Wizards now, so she can't play competitively, I guess.
Yeah.
It's unfortunate. I think Jackie's at Wizards now, too, so we're losing a lot of Wizards. Yeah. Come on, Wizards, what are you doing?
Hello, Wizards.
But, you know, role models like that are great because you see them on the pro level and on the main stage, and they give you something to aspire to. The other role models are the women, much like your, I assume yourself, Gaby, who are at FNM. Support them the way this article says, because they're out there, they're doing this, and the more we support everybody as a community, black, white, female, male, transgender, whatever, the more we open our doors to everybody coming in. And that's important. It's very important to just know that by doing those kinds of things, by being acceptable, by working with people, by trying to say to yourself, hey, I'm going to actively engage in with the community and trying to make the community better, you're being that role model. And you're helping support women, men, you know, people with poor hygiene, people with great hygiene. I mean, whatever it is, you're supporting that community, and that's our community. That's something we all have to take care of and be vigilant of. And these things that we talk about with, like, being beat by a girl, or I had a bet that a girl couldn't do this, or, wow, you know, even, geez, I can't believe I'm playing against a girl at FNM. Even when they're not mean-spirited, we talk about them in the hopes that by talking about them, we can just think about them more. Because I think once you're more conscious of these things, we do better. Because we're a really good community. This community is so great.
Yeah, like, the community is excellent.
Yeah.
It really is.
And the thing is, like, most gamers are so intelligent, and they, you know, it's like when you sit down and think about it, it's like, oh, yeah, okay, this makes sense. This isn't changing my world here. It makes sense. So we can all do better. But, okay, so that was the final thoughts on Women in Magic. We have this pro player draft.
Right.